गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल डियर लर्नर्स, रेस्पेक्टेड सोहन पांडे सर, रेस्पेक्टेड भावेश सर. टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट ए न्यू सब्जेक्ट और कोर्स दैट इज डेटाबेस मैनेजमेंट सिस्टम CSP 43. सो सर विल टेक क्लास दैट इज फर्स्ट फर्स्ट ब्लॉक इंट्रोडक्शन ब्लॉक इंट्रोडक्टरी ब्लॉक. सो आई रिक्वेस्ट सोहन सर टू स्टार्ट द सेशन. Sir, please start the session. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We are going to discuss. I am audible. We are going to discuss the database management system in detail. We are just going to discuss the first block of the DBMS. We have three blocks. I am going to complete the first block. We'll try to complete the first block. Okay. I am sharing my screen. If my screen is not visible, please respond.
Learner are requested to mute their mic.
My screen also, my screen is visible or not?
Sir? Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Then, actually, what is DBMS? And before going to DBMS, we must need to know what is the data, what is information, and what is the role of DBMS in our future, in our current situation, current world. Then, what is data? First thing is, what is the information? Before going to data, we need the information. For example, what is the information? Anything related, anything documented, any information about the body, entity, object. We are saying it like it is object oriented, but what is object? Anything. That may be a book in real world, that book, that may be a person, that may be a tree, anything, school, building, that is an entity, and that may be an object. And any information about that object?
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir?
Yes.
Is it possible to maximize the screen?
Yes, yes, I'm going to do that.
Okay, please. Okay, sir.
Yes, one second. Okay, sir. I actually am not even able to make it full.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir.
Continue. Left it. Okay. It is visible. Okay.
Okay,
sir. Continue.
Okay. Then what is before going to that is any information about any real world object is called we are calling it information or data. And the present world is a data driven world because we can say in short term we can say that. If any person has a lot of data, then he is the richest person. In our present world, a person having money is not a rich person, but a person having a large number of data is called a rich person. We can say he is a rich person. For example, in the past year, one person, Mark Zuckerberg, purchased WhatsApp. Then what the thing he has purchased? He purchased the database of the WhatsApp. Not the WhatsApp application. It means that all the data of the all the users, data of all the users he purchased from WhatsApp. There is no going to where then he is going to use those data in for to make any type of profit. That's why it is called data driven. Then what is a DBMS? if we have a large amount of data, we need a system to manage that heavy amount of data in a perfectly manner or systematic manner. That's why we need a DBMS, database management system. There are different types of DBMS, RDBMS. We are going to discuss what is DBMS, what is RDBMS, what are the existing file system, what are the disadvantages or advantages of the file system, what is the advantage of DBMS, and what is the advantage of the RDBMS. We are going to learn that things. Okay. Then what is a DBMS? Then we can see that DBMS allows user the following tasks. What are the following tasks? Data definition, data updation, data retrieval, and user administration. Then what are the these things? Data definition. For example, I want to save a data or save the student data in some kind of database. For example, I am using Oracle or many database systems are available, Oracle, MySQL, SQL Server, SQL DB Plus. There are different types of softwares are available. There are DBMS softwares available. For example, I want to save the student data. Then I am going to create a table in the name of student data or something. Then I will create some column name like student roll number, student mark, student name, student mobile number, student email address. This kind of thing will I have to keep it. Then I am going to update the data. These are the kind of things we are going to do. That is the definition. But the data updation, because one data is not constant for all the time. Because I can say that, so I have some data at 2 years before 2 years, then the data is obsolete. I can say the data is obsolete because every day the data and the knowledge about the data is continuously changing. So we have to update the data in a systematic manner, in an effective manner. So that the user can get the actual data and the current data in the present scenario. What is the data retrieval? Then if I am going to save the data, then I am, next thing I have to do is the retrieve the data. Because for example, I am searching for a photo or searching for a data in the internet. What is the mechanism here? I am requesting the server to search for the data. The server is actually searching the database, for that word, and when the server finds that word in some location, then he is sending me the location. I am viewing the file. That is the simple thing in the internet works. In the simple manner in the internet works. That is a data retrieval. Then next thing is user administration, because user administration is that, for example, there is a database and the data is used by different users. Different users means there may be a large number of users, not a single user using the database, a large number of users using the database. The users may have different types of authentication level. For example, authorization level. For example, let's take an example of Facebook. Okay. For example, technically speaking, if I have a proper username or authenticated username and password, I can log into Facebook database system. But if I am not authorized to make a comment on my friend's post, then I am not authorized user. Because if the person on the person on which post on the wall, on which post I am going to comment, if I am not able to do so, then I am not an authorized user. I may be authenticated user, I am not maybe authorized user. There is a difference between authenticated user and authorization user. For example, take the example of banking system. The banking system, the person sitting at the counter, he has the authorized to make a deposit or withdrawal up to a limit of 1 lakh. After that 1 lakh amount, he has to get an authorization from a hierarchy or higher officer. That is the authorization or user administration. There is different kind of thing we are going to discuss. What are the characteristics of the DBMS? Characteristics of DBMS is it uses a digital respiratory system established server to store and manage information. We can say that all the data are retrieved and stored in a digital, so not in a file manner, we have book manner or file system. It is the total DBMS present virtually. It can provide a clear and logical view of process that manipulated data. That means what? Logical view. That means actually, I am going to, when we discuss about DBMS, there will be different types of view: physical view, logical view, and conceptual view. What do you mean by logical view and physical view and conceptual view? That means, for example, data is present in a tabular manner. That is a physical view. But how I am going to access the data? For example, I want to know the students in a class who has scored above than 60% and who is resident of Sambalpur. This kind of data I want to know. This is the logical view. I am putting any type of logic. But what is the logic that I want to view the record of the students who has scored more than 60% in the exam and who are the residents of Sambalpur. This is the logic. But in the physical structure, in the physical view, they are not related. All the data is present in a tabular manner, not in the manner that the data is present in Sambalpur district one data, Balangir district another. No. All the data is present in a tabular manner. But I want in a logical view. So we can say that there is a logical view and the physical view and the conceptual view. I am going to discuss in detail. Then next thing is DBMS contains automatic backup and recovery procedure. All the data needs a backup and recovery procedure because any type of solar power failure, any type of electronics failure that may happen. That's why DBMS needs a backup procedure. Actually, if you are using WhatsApp, you can say that there is also backup procedure. At the evening, at the night time, around 3 a.m., it go for a backup procedure. What do you mean backup? If any accidental, your phone, all the data is deleted or your phone is damaged, then in the later time, you just have to install the WhatsApp and you can retrieve your data from your WhatsApp server or Google server. It actually backups in the Google server. You can get the backup. Then it is the content of ACID property. I am going to discuss what is ACID property. ACID is atomicity, consistency, isolation, and durability. I am going to discuss part of the ACID property in details. Okay, this is the introduction part. It can reduce the complexity, complex relationship between data. Because if there is any type of data present in the real world, there is different type of complexity. For example, take the example of parent or child. This is simple. So one father has two child, then there is a simple relationship. One person has two child, there is a relationship between father and son. But son is living in Australia and father is living in India. Then there will be a different type of data according to the residence. Then there will be complex. To handle that type of complexity, we need a database system which efficiently manages this kind of complexity. I'm going to discuss all the details. Okay. Then it can use provide security of data. Yes, I have already discussed. What is the security of data? Security of data means if a person is not authenticated user, means he has not a proper password. Actually, if you are going to use Oracle, you need a username and password. If you don't have the username and password, you cannot access that Oracle or database. That's why it is secured and it is encrypted. Okay. It can view the database from different viewpoints according to the requirement of the user. I have already described. If one person wants to see the students' mark on record of the students who has scored above 60%, he can see. If you want to see students whose name starts with L alphabet, he can see. This is the kind of different logic he can put and he can view the data in different manner. That's why they are the different characteristics of DBMS. What are the advantages of DBMS? Controls database redundancy. What do you mean redundancy? Redundancy means, for example, take the example of Wi-Fi. I am putting generally in the day-to-day life, we are putting different records in Excel file or Wi-Fi. Suppose I have an Excel file containing and I want to put all the marks of my students in that Excel file. It may happen that I have already entered the roll data for roll number 12. And again, after some time, one day I just thought that I have not inserted the data for the roll number 12. And I am after one or day or two, I am going to repeatedly insert that data. Then Excel sheet will receive the data. It will not generate or give an error message that you have already entered the message or there is a data already present for roll number 12. No, it will not give any type of message. There may be data redundancy. What is another type of redundancy? For example, there are two Excel sheets. Suppose one Excel sheet is present at the reception level or office, and another Excel sheet present at the teacher level. Then, for example, at the time of admission, the student has furnished a wrong information, like there is a spelling mistake in his name. Then, after some days, the student realizes that my name is actually misspelled in the database. So I am going to update that. He is going to the reception at the office and the office staff has updated that file, the Excel file. But if the Excel file is present locally at the system or present at the office, so for the same roll number 12, the name present at the Excel file present at the reception or office staff is not equal to the is not same as the Excel file present at the teacher. There may be different name, so there may be a redundancy. But my data sharing, I can easily share the data. I am just before in the previous example, there is no sharing of data, but in the DBMS we can easily share the data. Easy maintenance, reduced time. Easy maintenance means I can generally export, import, maintenance. I have to clear some data, add some data, update some data. It is a kind of easy maintenance. Reduced time. Suppose in the Excel file, I want to find the student record getting more than 60 marks. Then if the data is present in the Word file, it is hardly possible, next to impossible to find all the records record of the students who have scored more than 60%. No, it is impossible. But in DBMS, it is possible. Okay, there is backup. There is no backup system in your files in generation, but in DBMS, it is a backup system is present. Then multiple ledger interface. For example, there is an Excel file. Take the example of the Excel file present in a system. So whenever any user wants opens that Excel file, he can view all the data and all the same format. The view will be same for all the users. It will not show that you can edit, you can delete. No. For one user, only 10 students mark is showing. For another user, total 100 student marks is showing. No, it will not going to happen. But in DBMS, it may happen because you have restricted that. Suppose there is a large organization, one person present in regional office, he can see the data of the regional employee. Then he can see only 10 employee or 20 employee, but the person present at the journal office, he can see all the records. Then you can say that there is a different view for different users. Okay, what is the disadvantage of DBMS? Disadvantage of DBMS is going for the cost, hardware, software. Then cost of hardware and software means we need a external. If you are going to install the database like Oracle, MySQL, DBMS, any software, we need a large amount of space. Then if a large amount of space is required, then it requires some processing capacity. That's why we need, there is a cost associated with the kind of DBMS for hardware and software. Size, it surely costs some size, like it runs on a high memory. So we need a large amount of space in primary memory and your secondary memory also. Okay, high impact of payload. For example, if the database is a single system, a single centralized server, centralized distributed system, centralized DBMS, then it may possible that all the system may corrupt. For example, there is an electrical failure or mechanical failure at the server, then the whole data will be damaged. There may be a possibility, but in today's world, the chances are very thin. There is no possibility because there is a mirror imaging, mirror processing with different type of backup procedures available. So it is like impossible to lose all the data. But yes, there is a chance of possibility we can lose the data. Then we are going for that. What is the database? It is simple. We have already discussed. Now, what is the evolutionary database? I am going to discuss. For example, there are different types of database here. First one is hierarchical model. We can see that in the hierarchical, in the present, as the diagram shows, that there is a company. In the company, there are different types of users, devices, applications. And the users is divided into two parts, marketing and person. Like devices can be divided into more number parts, and application may be divided into more number parts. This type of representation is called structural or hierarchical data model. It is a hierarchical data model. But what is the network model? Network model means network developing. It is Honeywell and integrated data source. It was developed in 1960. In this model, files are related as owner and member, like to common network model. Owner means, for example, there is a car and there is a car owner. This is a relation between owner and car. Then car has different property, then there will be a network model. So in this way, the network model works. The network data model is identified with the following component: network schema, sub schema, data model. It is already older person. We are just going through it. Evolution. Then the next thing is from relational model. What is a relational model? Relational model, we are talking about relation. General relation, we in our world, relation is a table. We are actually calling a table is a relation, because in a table, suppose I am creating a table for student, then student is a relational table, then in this table, what will you present? Student name, student ID, student mark, student role address, email address, these different kind of information will present. And each row will hold the record of each student. I'm going to explain it in detail. Okay, then a cloud database. As you know, there in the present scenario, cloud database is very much popular. For example, if you are using Gmail and you are sending a file of more than 25 MB, then it will ask that you must share the file with a Google Cloud. That means your file will be uploaded to a cloud and a link will be shared to the recipient. Because you are sending as a mail, then the link will be shared to the recipient. And if you are going to give the access link, then the recipient can access or download or edit the file. This is cloud database. What is the cloud database? Advantage of it is a lower cost, it is automated, and increased accessibility. Anyone can access. It is actually lower cost. If you are using Google Cloud, Microsoft Azure or Amazon Web Service, it is kind of simple, low cost. Actually, Google is providing free of cost for 15 GB. Above 15 GB, you have to pay some cost or you have to get the premium membership or premium G Suite. Okay. Lower cost and it is scalable also. That's what you mean by scalable. Scalable means at any point of time you can increase your Google Cloud site or you can decrease your Google Cloud site. This is the simple advantage or different kind of advantage provided by your cloud database. Okay, there is a new concept is coming in today world. There is no SQL database. What is no SQL database? It is no SQL means no means there is no present of SQL. It is not. It no SQL means not only SQL. Not only SQL means in this no SQL, only SQL is not used. Beside SQL, graph theory, network, every different kind of database is used. And in the combination of this, the no SQL is created. Okay, we are going to discuss about the things. It is the advantages of a no SQL is highly scalable, highly available. That means scalability means if any point of time today I don't have any work, I just need only 1 MB space or 2 MB space, then it is okay. But suddenly in tomorrow session, I have some big work, big assignment I have to do. I have to do a big assignment. I need a higher space. Then I can easily scalable it. Then easily increase my memory size. Then it is called highly scalability or highly available. Disadvantage of NoSQL is it is open source. As it is open source, there is a possibility of security issues, then maybe management issues, or GUI is not available. So GUI is the graphical user interface is not available. And also there is a problem with backup also. Then there is an object-oriented database. Object-oriented database means anything present in our world is called an object. And different type of we have already heard of different type of language. There is a presently object-oriented programming language. What is an object-oriented programming? Suppose object is something that is present in the real world and we can reuse it. Simple object, you know, object-oriented means we can reuse it, we can inherit it. There are different kind of properties like object, classes, inheritance, polymorphism, encapsulation. What do you mean by object? Object is any real world object. Now, what is the instance? Any instance of that object class is called any present scenario or present instance is called that instance. For example, student is a class. For example, student is a class and any student of that class is called an instance or object. Then there is a class. Then inheritance. For example, what do you mean by inheritance? For example, I am teaching in silicon. Let's take the example of silicon. For example, the uniform color of silicon is something black and white. Black and white. Then every class belongs to the silicon engineering college have to perform or have to go through that uniform. And then the uniform color will be inherited from the silicon college. That means what is the property of the base class? The property of the base class will be inherited to the inherited class or in the class we are going to inherit the base class. Okay. What is polymorphism? Polymorphism is many form. Actually, it is polymorphism, many and morphism of the view. The polymorphism means that one function and one object will like or act as different type in different nature in different circumstances. Then that will be a polymorphism. What do you mean encapsulations? Encapsulations means, for example, encapsulate. That is a capsule type. What is a capsule? In that capsule, different types of ingredients are present, or different types of particles are present. But we are taking it is a single component or single amino. That means we don't know. We don't have to worry about the what are present inside that capsule. We're just taking that capsule for our benefit. They're like that. For example, there is a class. There may be a complex structure inside that class, but we are taking just the object of the class, and we are getting it. So this is the property of our encapsulation. Okay, the relation database property, I am going to discuss the atomicity, consistency, integrity, duality, what are these kind of, I will going to discuss it. And there is a next type of database, what is the graph database. In general, social networking side, these type of database are used, that is a graph database. A graph database is also a NoSQL database. That means there is a set theory, we can use a set theory. This box, this round or this shape represents employee, this shape employee company, and this is some city. That means employee is the manager of that company and it present in this city. In this type of graph type, we can also depend on different type of database. Okay. Already we have already discussed about the advantages of disadvantages of database. Then I am going for what is the actual difference between the DBMS and the file system, and we are going for the database. Okay. Before that, DBS and DBMS file system. What is the DBMS and file system? Then simple, there are different only six to seven difference. What are the difference between the file system is a collection of data in the system. The user has to write the procedure for managing the database. Okay, that means file system is a location actually present in the local system. For example, file system, if you are accessing a file system, there is a different kind of possibility. It is not possible those operations to do in a Python, those are available in DBMS. DBMS is a collection of data. In DBMS, the user is not required to write the procedure, but in a file system, it is required to write the procedure. What is the procedure? I am going to discuss it in detail. Okay. The file system provides the detail of the data representation storage of the data. That means if you are using file system, for example, Excel system, I can see that where the my Excel sheet is present in that drive, in that location, I can easily see that. But in DBMS, you cannot know. If you will be providing user interface, there may be a graphical interface, there may be a command line interface. We can use Oracle, for example, taking the example of Oracle. You can access the Oracle server through your Mozilla Firefox and web browser, or you can go for command line. You don't have to worry about whether the data is present in the C drive, A drive, or C drive, this block, and this file. You don't have any idea. Okay. But file system, it can easily solve that this file is present in this directory and this file and this location. Okay. And DBMS provides crash recovery mechanism, but DBMS protects the user from the system failure. That means crash mechanism. Because, for example, you are making any type of transaction, and in between that time, your system is failure. Actually, there is a power failure or mechanical failure in your system. Then what will happen? DBMS can roll back to a previous state, previous stable state, or it can give and back. But file system has no any request system. So for example, you are making an Excel, writing an Excel file, and in the meantime, your power goes up, then you can lose all the data. That may happen in file system. Or DBMS provides a good protection mechanism. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Audible.
Okay. So, one error message. My screen is visible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The file system cannot effectively store and retrieve the data. That I have already discussed why the file system cannot effectively store the data. For example, I have an Excel file containing different student marks. Then I am going to enter any new mark. He cannot show any message that for this one already I have inserted the data or there is no data. It cannot show any type of error message. This is the kind of thing. And second thing is the file system cannot deal with the authentication or authorization system. You can give a file system a username and password, but password, you can encrypt that file or you can secure that file with kind of different kind of password. provided by the operating system, but it is not like a MySQL and DBMS. DBMS gives better security, better protection for the files or data. Then what is authorization? There is a difference between authorization. I already told you that if a file is opened by any user, if the Excel file is opened by any user, he can view all the data and all the records. But in DBMS, the data or the database or the table will be shown to the user as per the grant or as per the authority granted to that user. If the user has no authorization of viewing given data or all the data, he cannot view. There may be a possibility, there may be authorization of read, write, delete, different kind of authority can be given in database management system. Okay, these are the difference between DBMS file system. Then what are the types of database? Already I have discussed there are different types of database. Part one is centralized database, distributed database, NoSQL database, cloud database, relational database, network database, object database, and hierarchical database. In short, we have already discussed what are the different type of database. Okay. For example, centralized database. What are the advantages and disadvantages of a centralized database? For example, there is a risk, it has decreased the risk of data manager. If the data is present in centrally, it will be job for one person to handle the data. Although you just don't have to manage the data or have to check the data on the database. This is simply it is the role of a DBA or database administrator who is going to control all the data, centralized data. Data consistency is maintained as it manages data in the central repository. Data consistency means, for example, one file contains some name, roll number 12, some name, and another file contains roll number 12, other name. It will not happen in centralized database system. It will be consistent. It provides better data quality, which enables organization to establish data standards. Okay. What is the disadvantage? There is a disadvantage like that. If all the data will be present in the centralized system, then there will be a chance that it will require a high memory. And suppose the high also provided by high memory and high capacity of primary memory, it may happen. You are going to search anything in the database. It will take some time to search all the throughout the database. It may happen. So it is a disadvantage of a centralized database. And the single point failure, yes, there is a disadvantage like single point failure. But what is the advantage of distributed database? Distributed database means there are different types of distributed database. The one is homogeneous, one other is heterogeneous. Homogeneous database means if the database is running on the same type of operating system, same type of application by same type of application, then it is homogeneous. For the database is running on different type of operating system and used by different type of application, then you can say it is a heterogeneous database system. But what the advantage of distributed database? In present world, many of the databases are distributed, not they are single. For example, taking the example of Google. If you are accessing a google.com, it will not show you google.com. It will redirect to a google.co.in. Why it is that? Because .com is present, suppose with the .com server is present, the data will be retrieved from the US. But for example, you are searching for a local data, the maximum the data used by the Indian people or Indian audience, that will be stored in the Indian server. Why they are going to store the whole data in the US server? No, because if the data, maximum data, I am not saying that all the data you are fetching from India, that will be present in the India. It will not possible. It may be present in the US, but maximum the data will be present in the Indian server that are viewed by the Indian audience. Okay, so this is the main disadvantage of distributed database system. Already relational database system. What is a relational database system? Relation means, actually there is a relation, relation means table. A table means, when there is a table, in a table there is a column and a row. What do you make column? Column represents any type of entity for example, student. In student table, there will be entity. What was the entity? Sorry?
Sir, have you shared? Sir, apna share karchanti ki?
Yes, yes. Screen share ajauni ki?
Na, dekhau ni to.
Okay.
Abhi dekhel.
Okay. There is actually I'm in college and there is a continuous network and electricity problem. Okay. Okay. Then what is the property of relational database management system? Then yes, in a student table, if a column, what is a column? Column name, maybe a student name, student address, student roll number, student mark. These are the different kind of entity. And what is the each row will represent? For example, roll number one. Each row will represent a record of a student. Then, if you have 30 number of students, there will be 30 number of rows. In this way, we are going to do the relational database system. Now, what are the properties of relational database system? ACID property. It is very much important. ACID property. A stands for atomicity, C stands for consistency, I stands for isolation, D stands for durability. What do you mean by atomicity? Atomicity means it is either all, otherwise null. That means what is meant? For example, you are making any type of transaction, and in between the transaction, your system is corrupted or there is a problem, an electrical failure. Then what will happen? Either it will go for the end state or it will roll back to the previous state. It will not hang in between them. That is called atomicity. That means either all the transactions will be reflected, otherwise all the transactions will be aborted. It is called committed or aborted. That is called atomicity. Either one or zero. Either it will happen or it will not happen. It will all be discarded. So then there is a C stands for consistency. It is important. It will appear in exam. Consistency. What is my consistency? If we perform any type of operation over data, then value before and after the operation, that must be consistent. For example, in an account of a person, there is a rupees of 300 rupees present in one account. Then if he deposits another 50 rupees, then the total amount will be deflected 350. Then must not be 320 or 380. There is a consistency with the before transition and after transition. The data should match. That is called consistency. What do you mean? Isolation. Isolation means, for example, there may be concurrent data. For example, the same Facebook server is used by different users. But one transaction is carried by one user should not affect the other transaction carried by other regions. That must be doing isolation. For example, I am viewing my Facebook page. It must not affect someone is using his or her Facebook page. It may not affect. That's called isolation. That means any transaction must do in isolation state. Isolation. Then D means durability. Durability means it ensures once it completes the operation, it commits the data. Data should remain permanently. Because what there is a commit and but for example, I have already done my transaction, then there will be commit. After committing the data, the change in the data is permanent. The change in the database is permanent. There will be no change after the committing the data. Okay. For example, actually, what happens? For example, take the example of banking transaction system. If you have sent any money. If you are making any request to send the money or receiving any money, after the money is received, there will be commit command. After the commit command is executed, there will be no abort command. There will be no reflection or there will be no rollback from present state to previous state. That is called durability. Or any time there will be a crash or electronic problem, mechanical problem, the data must persist. That is called durability. Okay. I already discussed about NoSQL database. Actually, NoSQL database is divided into four types. One is four types of database. One is key value storage, graph database, wild column storage, and document oriented database. One. Okay. What is a key value storage? Key value storage, it is a simple type of database storage where it is stored every single item as a key. That means key value, name, my name. Phone number, my phone number. This way, key and value. This kind of dependency is called key value oriented. Document oriented is kind of like that. In our, for example, if you are developing an Android app, you must have about JSON. What is JSON? The data in which main or in which view the database will be, the application will use that data. The data will present in that command. JSON is a common format to use or communicate between Android application and the server. First, the data will be retrieved from the server and it will be converted into a JSON file. And the JSON document will all the data. Whenever the end application want to retrieve the data, it will retrieve the data from the JSON file. So you can say JSON is a document oriented database. Okay. Then over the graph database, I have already shown you the graph database. Graph means there will be a graph like structure, and it is commonly used in social networking websites. Okay. Then the wide column area. Wide column area is actually similar to the relational database. We have already discussed that the table, but in here the data is stored in a large column instead of storing in row. In we are using different rows to suppose you are using 30 rows for store the data, 30 zone. But in wide column store, the 30 student will be data will be inserted in maybe one wide column. That is the advantage. There is the wide column storage. Advantage of NoSQL, it enables good productivity, it have better option for managing handling large data set, it provides high scalability, and user can quickly access any database. Okay. I have already discussed about what is a cloud database, Microsoft, Amazon, Google, ScienceSoft, these are different cloud database, they are providing a cloud database. Okay. Okay, these are the different kind of database we have already discussed. Okay, then I am going for the database DBMS architecture. So what do you mean DBMS architecture? We are dividing the DBMS architecture into three types. First one is one tier architecture, second one is two tier architecture, and third one is three tier architecture. Okay, then what do you mean by one tier architecture? One tier architecture means there is no layer, there is directly user to the database. This is called one type of database layer. For example, I am using my Oracle server in my local computer. You can say that this is one tier architecture. At one tier architecture, if the database is directly available to the user, it means user can directly sit on the database and can use it. Any changes done here will directly be done onto the database. I am directly updating or deleting the database, and the transaction will be reflected directly onto the database itself. But what do you mean two-tier architecture? Just like see the diagram. These are two things. The one will be server, another will be client. Then client has user application and server the database system. In the two-tier architecture, user has to use the server. User is to use the same basic client server. In the two-tier application, the client and can directly communicate with the database server at the server side. For example, Oracle is a two-tier architecture. We can say that Oracle is server. Server means we have to go to the server, we have to install the Oracle server or Oracle database, then I am going to access the database. Then I have to go to the browser. Browser, in the browser, if you are using access to Oracle home page, and then we have to write the localhost colon 8080/APA is the URL to access the Oracle database. In this way, you can use that or access the database. Okay. But what will be a three-tier architecture? In the three-tier, in the day-to-day life, we are using a three-tier architecture. There will be application server and a database. For example, Java. Take the example of advanced Java. Advanced Java is in the kind of advanced Java or database, we are using three-tier architecture. For example, there is a web page. The web page is the front layer that is shown to the user. And then when the data is sent, there is a web page and there is a form present in the web page. The user is inserting the data, then the form data will be sent to the application server. You can say the JSP or servlet. Then the server, the servlet is a middle layer. Then what the servlet and JSP will be? Then servlet and JSP will redirect the data into the database or Oracle or MySQL, whatever the database present at the backside. Then this is a three layer, because HTML or the front view, we are viewing at the front layer or past layer. Second layer is the solver layer, JSP, solver, PHP. Then the third layer is a database layer that is the present at the backend. That means user don't have to worry whether the data is present in my Oracle database or MySQL database. We don't know, because if you are using a Facebook, we don't have an idea and then whether the data is present in the MySQL server, DBMS server, or another server. And the server has no idea the which region is existing for data, because the server, the PHP, JSP, that part, the server application server, is actually managing the both the things. That is why it is called three-tier architecture. You can easily view this kind of this thing in this diagram. This is the three-tier architecture. Okay. Then next thing is that three schema architecture. What is a schema? Schema very is an important thing. What is schema? The three schema architecture is also called ANSI structure or three level architecture. There are different type of architecture. First one, that is database. Above the database, the three structure: internal level, conceptual level, and external level. What are the this thing? It shows the DBMS architecture internal level. What do you mean internal level? Internal level describes the physical storage or physical structure of the database. Means this internal level, it will how the database or how the database table are present in the which sector, how the database table in the physically present in the this will be sorted in the internal level. The uses of physical data model is used to depend on how the data will be stored in a block. The physical level is used to describe the complex low level structure in details. This is the internal level. But what is the next level? It's called conceptual level. What is the conceptual level? The conceptual scheme describes the design of the database at the conceptual level and not the logical level. Logical level, the conceptual scheme describes the structure of the whole database. That means how many tables I am going to use. What are the attributes? How many numbers of columns will be present in each table? And what will be the key, primary key? What will be the foreign key? What is the relationship between one table and another table? These are the kind of logic will be present at the conceptual level. In the conceptual level, internal details such as implementation of the data structure are hidden. Programmers and data administrator work at this level. Actually, we work this level. But what is the external level? At the external level, database contains several schema that sometimes called as sub-schema. The sub-schema is used to describe the different view of the database. That means if any user wants to see all his images or all his maps, how those data will be viewed. This is describing the external level. There will be a button. We have to check the button. Above 60%, all the students having scored above 60% will be displayed. Now, this is the external level. These are the levels which will be shown to the users. And this is why the all the different levels are present, because in DBMS, internal level, conceptual level, and external level are different. Because if you have any database administrator is going to change any type of level, make any type of change in any level, it will not reflect in another level. For example, I am changing in the internal level. For example, I have shifted my database from Oracle to MySQL. But the viewer or the user using the database or accessing the data, he will express zero change in his view, because he or she is not going to suffer any type of change due to the change in the internal level or physical level. If I am changing the conceptual level, for example, I am changing the logic, I am changing the primary key, foreign key, or any type of active, I am increasing the column size, it will not reflect how the data will be viewed to the user. It will be the same. For example, take the example. Before one to two, in the Facebook post, there will be only one like. But at that time, the data will be stored for one like. But in the recent Facebook update, there are six options, like six different type of emotion present to the post. Then according to the current update, the new users, the current users are actually inserting the data according to the current environment. But take the example, the user has, I have liked the post in before 2 years, then what will it show? It will now show only like. But adding to the beside the like button, there are extra six emotion buttons present in the Facebook. This is the kind of updation, because these are the kind of change in the conceptual way. But the user using the Facebook don't have to worry about what is the change in the conceptual level or what is the change in the internal level. This is the different type of three levels architecture. Okay. We are using what is the data model. Okay. What is data model? Data model is the modeling of the data abstraction, data semantics, consistency in the importance of the data. At the constraints, I am going to discuss semantic data description. Actually, data models are of four types: relational, semi-structured, entity relationship, object-based data model. Relationship data model, relational data model. What do you mean relational data model? This type of model is designed in the form of rows and columns with a table. Table, if you are using table, the heading will show the entity, or under each row will having the data of each student or each person. That is the simple relationship. But the entity relationship model, actually, it is whenever you are designing any type of data, but your relationship or your data model is very much used in different type of database designing. What is a ER model? I'm going to discuss the ER model in detail. What is a ER model? For example, take the example of a teacher student. Here, teacher is an entity and student is an entity. But what is the relationship between them? It is a one is to many. Because one teacher has many number of children, then there will be a relation there. One is to many relationship. Because one entity is teacher, one entity is student, relationship is one to many. Then what are the attributes? The property or the property that are going to describe the teacher or describe the student, that will be entity, that will be attribute. For example, for a teacher, what will the property? In teacher's name, teacher class, teacher residence, teacher ID, these are the different type of properties, these are the attributes. Like that, student, student name, student roll number, student mark, student class, student grade, these are the student properties which are going to define the student. And these are the different things. And this type of model is called ER relationship model. And we are going to discuss it. The object-oriented model, an extension of ER model is called object-oriented model. Because with some kind of extra functionality. What is the extra functionality object? It is going for a function like encapsulation, object identity, polymorphism, inheritance. There's a kind of object-oriented property enabled by object-based data model. But a semi-structured data model. Semi-structured data model is the example of XML file. This type of data model is different from another three data. But this semi-structured data model allows the data specific in a place where the individual data atoms of the same type may be different attributes. The extensible Markov language. We have used the XML. For example, if you are using XML to store the data, you can use, for example, XML is actually the tag language. XML is a tag language. How you have to store the data? For example, you have to store the data name and roll number. Then you can use the tag name in between the opening and closing tag of name. You can put the name and roll number. You have to write opening tag, closing tag, roll number, and between that you can put the roll number. This is the way you can use the XML set. I will explain later how the XML data is also used. Okay. Then we are going for a data model schema. These are the something different I have already discussed. It is a student schema. Student schema means name, student number, class, major. Course, this is course table, course schema, and course schema has four number of columns, course name, course number, credit award, department. In this way, all the different tables or schemas are present. Okay. Then data independence. I have already told that there is a different type of, there is a three layer, logical, conceptual, and external. Like that, independence. There is a data independence. Data independence of two types. What is a logical data independence? Another physical data independence. That means if any type of change is done in the logical level, that must not affect the physical level. Like same way, if any type of change in the physical level, that must not be affected in the logical level. This is the already I have discussed the external level, logical level, and physical level. That's why. The physical data independence can be defined as the capacity to change the internal schema without having to change the conceptual schema. If you do any change in storage size, database server, the conceptual structure of the database will be not be affected. Simple. If I also, for example, I am changing my whole database from Oracle to MySQL. Yes, I can port my all the data from one server to another server, but there will be no change in the conceptual level or the external level for the user. This is called data independence, logical data independence and physical data independence. Likewise, if I can change the logic, I can increase the number of columns, I can increase the relationship between teacher and student, or one to many kind of relationship. User will, it can be changed at the logical level, but it will not going applied in the physical level. Okay, then I am going for what are the different type of DBMS languages. Actually, there are different types of DBMS language. It is not restricted to only four: DDL, DCL, DML, TCL. But apart from these four languages, there are more number of languages are used in current scenario, current day-to-day lives. But what is a DDL? DDL is a data definition language. For example, what is a data definition language? Data definition language structures includes create, alter, drop, truncate, rename command. What do you mean create? If you are going to create a table, we are using the create command. Alter table, if you are altering a name or altering a name or changing the structure of the data, it means DDL actually gives you the structure of the data, then structure of the table or schema of the table. Then we are using alter command. If I am to delete the table, I will use the drop command. Truncate, it will remove all the records from the table. Means a table contains 30 records. If I am using the drop command, the table will be deleted. But truncate means all the 30 records will be deleted, but the schema will present, the structure will present, but all the data will be deleted. Rename, I want to rename the table, I can go for that command. It is used to comment the data dictionary, comment on the data dictionary. Then these are the first things. If I am going to store the data, first I have to use the DDL, data definition language. Using the DDL, I have created a table, I have altered the schema, I have designed the schema, I have renamed all the things. Then the next part is called data manipulation language. After the creating the table, I have to insert the data, I have to update the data, I have to delete the data, I have to shuffle the data. Any type of operation that is called data manipulation language. What are the commands like select? Select, insert, update, delete, merge, call, extend, plan, lock table. Select, what do you mean select? Select command is used to retype the data. For example, there is a student table, and in the student table, roll number, name, mark is present. Only three columns are roll number, name, and mark. I want to view all the records. Then what will I do? What I am going to do? I will write select star from student table name, select star from table name, and then it will show all the records of all the three columns. But I can add any type of constant. I can add like comment like select star from student where mark is greater than 60. Then what will it show? The student record will be shown whose marks are greater than 60. I can choose for view one column or two column, like select name from student whose mark is greater than 60. I will going to explain all the things in practical view. I am going to install the Oracle how to do so. I will explain this in the next class. Okay, then like that select is used to fetch the record. Likewise, insert is used to insert the record. I can use the insert command, insert into table name. How the insert command is going to operate, I will explain it. Object to update a command, delete to delete a record, merge if I will using any type of merging command, call command, explain plan, lock table. They are kind of commands I will demonstrate all in practical session. Okay. Then data control language. What do you mean data control language? There are different data control. How an user going to view the data? There is a data control. It may be two types: grant or revoke. Grant revoke means I am giving and permission a user to view the language or store the data. I will grant. I am granting that. Revoking that means I am withdrawing the grant command. That means there are following operations which have the authorization of revoke: connect, insert, ingest, execute, delete, update, select. Means one user can do what type of operation. This can be granted or revoked from a user. Okay, these are the data control language. Then another is a transaction control language. I have already discussed about commit and roll. What do you mean commit? If a user is performing five transactions, all the five transactions are successful. After the successful completion of the five transactions, he has to use the commit command. Commit command, what do you command? After committing the record, all the changes will be reflected permanently. Then there will be no rollback from the commit. What do you mean rollback? In between the transaction, any type of mishappening, any type of power failure or electrical failure happens, and in type of internet failure happens, then what will happen? All the record or the transaction will be rolled back to the previous present, previously stable state. Stable state means where from the stable state where the transaction is stored. We can say that what is the previous state? At the stage where previously the transaction was previous transaction was committed, because for example, take the example ABC. At the end step beginning, all the transaction, all the state database state was at A, state A. After some transaction, it comes to B, and then commit command is executed. Then the permanent changes is applied to the database, and the current state is B. And from B to C, when the transaction when the user is doing the transaction, in between, in the meantime, any type of failure occurs, then it will be rolled back to point B, not to C, not to A. That means when going from B state to C state, if any type of misappearing occurs, then it will roll back to point B, because B is a stable state. This is the kind of commit and rollback we are going to use also in practical session. Okay, we have already discussed what is a UR model. Then we are going to actually detail how UR model look like. Okay, for example, this is UR model stands for entity relationship model. It is a high level data model. This model is used to define the data elements and relationship of a specified program. Okay, for example, this is a student. And what are the entity of the student? What are the attribute? Name, address, age, ID. Because these name, address, ID, and age are going to define what is a student. And student is an entity. Okay, the component of a UR diagram, where we have to know. First one is entity, second one is attribute, third one is relation. Entity, there are different kind of entity, weak entity, strong entity, we are going to discuss. Attribute, there are different kind of attribute, key attribute, composite attribute, multivalued attribute, derived attribute. Relationship, one to one, one to many, many to one, many to many. Okay, what do you mean by entity? An entity may be any object, class, person, any place. For example, employee, department, anything, that may be an entity. But it may have some attributes. For example, in this diagram, employee is an entity, department is an entity. But what is the relationship between employee works for department? And it may be a many to one, because one department has many number of employees, it can have many to one relationship. Okay, then we are going for weak entity. An entity that depends on another entity is called weak entity. The weak entity does not contain any key attribute of its own. The weak entity is represented by dot double rectangle. Suppose entity is represented in the rectangular box. But here the installment loan and installment is also an entity, and loan is also an entity. But if any entity has no attribute, I am going to explain what is an attribute. If no key attribute, then we can say it is a key weak entity. If an entity has a key attribute, then we can say it is a strong entity or entity. But what is a weak entity? If an entity does not have any key attribute, we are saying it is a weak entity. Then we are going for an attribute. What do you mean by attribute? For example, student. What are the properties of the student? Student has ID, phone number, age, and name. These are the attributes of a student entity. We can say ID, age, phone number, and contact number can be attribute of a student. Then what do you mean by key attribute? Key attribute means actually we are referring as a primary key. We are referring as a primary key. For in this diagram, student has ID, and ID is actually a primary key, because if in a class there are certain number of students, each student will have a separate and unique identity number or unique ID. Then that's why it is called primary key. I'm going to discuss what is a primary key, composite key. We'll discuss in later. So for the moment, you will learn that this is a key attribute. These are the attribute, name, phone number, age are the attribute, or ID is the key attribute. That means if any entity doesn't have any key attribute, then we are saying it is a weak entity. Okay. Then there is a composite attribute. What do you mean a composite attribute? For example, name. I can divide the name into two parts, first name and last name. Then this will be a composite attribute, because this attribute, main attribute, is combined by three sub-attributes. We can sub-attribute. That means name is first name, middle name, last name. These are also attributes, but the name attribute is made of three attributes. That's why it is called composite attribute. Attribute that compose of many other attributes known as contribute attribute. Then I am going to, then all the attributes are represented like this. Composite attribute. Then we are going for the multi-value attribute. What do you mean multi-value attribute? An attribute can have more than one value. These attributes are known as multi-value because if attribute has more number, a student can have more number of telephone numbers. Always we are having more 1, 2, 2, 3, 4 numbers, then we can say phone number have multi-value. If a student has a mobile number, it may have one number and have a second number. Like this, we can say that multi-value attribute. Then another is derived attribute. What do you mean derived attribute? Because one age, for example, age. How the age is derived? Age is derived from the birth date. Attribute that can be derived from other attribute is known as derived attribute. For example, age. Age can be derived from the birth date. If a student has birth date is mentioned, then we can find out the age. Then this kind of attribute is called derived attribute because one attribute is can be derived from another attribute. Okay. It is derived attribute. Then one is, then another thing, then the third part is called relationship. What is a relationship? I have already discussed about different type of relationship: one to one, many to many, many to one, many to many. Okay. One to one means female to male. Actually, one female is married to one male. Then this type of relationship is called one to one relationship. But what will be one to many relationship? One to many relationship, one teacher, one number of students, it can be one to many relationship. Scientist, one scientist met any n number of investors, it can be represented one to many number of relationship. Okay, many to one, reverse, like student to course, x to one, many number of students have same number of course because MSc, PGDC, PGDC is studied by different number of students. Then we can say that m number of students are doing one course, then we can say m to one course. It is many to one relationship. Then what do you mean many to many relationship? Project. Different employees may be assigned with different number of projects. Suppose I have ABC project. Suppose person one have ABC project. Person two have CDE project. Then there is between A and C, there is a common project C. That's why you can say that one employee has more number of projects, or same project has more number of employees. Because if the C project, because one is, because employee one has A, B and C project. Employee two have C, D, E project. Then we can say that employee one has three projects, but the project C has two number of employees. We can say this type of relation is called many to many relationship. Many to many relationship. These are ER model. Then notation in ER diagram. What are the notation in ER diagram? We have already discussed one to one. For this one to one straight line, one to many. These are the one. These are many, many. Then one to more. The one and only one. Then we have to put double symbol, double bar. Then zero to one. Then zero to one. Zero to many. They are the kind of different type of symbols we can use. Okay. Then ER design. Then we are going for DBMS sketch. What do you mean DBMS sketch? We have already discussed about key attribute. Then what is a key? Key plays an important role in the relational database. It is used to uniquely identify any record or a row of a data from the table. If any table contains 30 number of student records, then how am I going to separate each student, or how am I going to fetch a record of a student, or how can I identify a student in that table? This is the use of primary key. It is used to establish the identity relationship between the tables. Okay. Then, for example, in the student, what are the student ID, name, access, address, course. But in a class, more than one number of students has same name, because Ashish, it may be present that more than one student have the same name. Maybe have same address, same course, but the ID will be different. No student will have the same ID. So that's called key attribute. Like that person, generally person name varies. Person name may be common, but if I am going to use the Aadhaar card number will be a key attribute, because no two person will have the same Aadhaar card number or Aadhaar number. Okay. Types of keys, there are different types of keys. What are the keys? One is primary key, candidate key, super key, foreign key. Okay, these are the important at the exam point of view. Okay, what do you mean by primary key? What do you mean by primary key? For example, this is the employee tuple. It is the first key which is used to identify one and only one instance of an entity uniquely. That means if in a table, if by using the primary key, I can uniquely identify a student or uniquely identify a group. An entity can contain multiple keys. We can see person table, the key which is not suitable. In the employee table, ID can be a primary key. See, it is unique for each employee. It must be unique. Primary key must be unique to each employee. In the employee table, we can even select license number and passport number as primary key since they are also unique. For example, employee along with the employee, the passport number or the license number, they are also unique to the each employee. So we can use that number also as a primary key. But generally, we are using it is up to the user convenience, but the database convenience, database DBA convenience, which type of to select the primary key or select the attribute as a primary key. For each entity, selection of the primary key is based on the requirement of the developers. Okay, this is the primary key. Now, what do you mean by candidate key? A candidate key is an attribute or set of attributes which can uniquely identify a tuple. The remaining attribute except for the primary key are considered a primary key. Simple thing. For example, in this table, if I am taking employee ID, suppose each employee can uniquely identify by employee ID also, passport number also, social security number, license number. If employee ID, passport number, license number, social. Each of these number can uniquely identify an employee. But I am taking employee ID as a primary key. Then the rest three, passport, license, and SSN will be candidate key. Means there are four number of keys which can uniquely identify the employee. Then one is primary key. Then rest three will be the candidate key. Then means primary key plus candidate key, all the keys. But except primary key, all the rest three key will be the candidate key. The candidate key means it may be, it has the potential to be a primary key. What do you mean by candidate key? It has the potential to be a primary key, but primary key only with the employee ID. But passport number can uniquely identify each employee. So it is a candidate key. Means candidate key, candidate to be a primary key. It's called a candidate key. Okay. What do you mean? Super key. The super key is a set of an attributes which can uniquely identify tuple. Super key is a super set of the candidate key. Simple, what is a super key? Super key is a super set of a candidate key. In the employee table, for employee ID, employee name, in the above employee table, for employee ID, employee name, the name of two employees can be the same, but their employee ID cannot be same. Hence, this combines can be also be a key. For example, super key. That means, for example, generally, ID with name. For example, ID, the employee may have, two employees may have the same name, but the employee have different ID. But if I am going to use both ID and name as a combined key, then what will happen? It is a super key. The super key will be employee ID. The super key will be employee ID. Or employee ID plus employee name in combination. In the combination, employee ID plus employee name will be a super key. Then it is a superset of the candidate key. We can use it is a superset. That means all the combination means candidate key also belongs to the super key. Primary key also belongs to the super. It is the superset of the key. Okay. What do you mean foreign key? Okay. Foreign key means foreign key are the column of the number of them which is used to point to the primary key of another table. That means in the employee, for example, employee belongs to any department and it is represented as a department ID. But department ID is a primary key of the department. There is a two table. First one is employee table, another one is department table. In the department table, department ID primary key, for employee table, employee ID is from primary key. But in the employee table, we have to keep an attribute or you have to keep a column of department ID. So department ID, that means in a table, one column refers to the another, refer to the primary key of another table, then it is called a foreign key. Foreign key are the column of the table which is used to point to the primary key of another table. It is called foreign key. They are the dependent key. Okay, it may ask, you know, what is the primary key, candidate key, super key, and foreign key. That may be, this can be asked in the primary, maybe asked in the exam. Then DBMS generalization. Okay, what do you mean DBMS generalization? Generalization is like a bottom-up approach in which two or more entities of lower level combine to form a higher level entity. That means faculty or student is a person. That faculty is also a person. Student is also a person. That is called generalization. I am generalizing a faculty or student as a person. Then the person, the property, all the property of the person will be inherited by faculty and student. In generalization, entities are combined to form a more generalized entity. Subclasses are combined to make a super class. Okay. Then DBMS specialization, it is a specialization approach. Okay. For the employee in generalization, we are making this generalized, but we can make it a specialized. For example, employee may be a tutor, employee may be a tester, employee may be a developer. Then we are using employee as a employee as a tester or a developer. These are the DBMS specialization. Okay. Converting where DBMS aggregation. Okay. Okay. This is the example of a Yard diagram. You can see in the student there are two course tables: student, course, subject, lecture. In the student table, there are different attributes: student name, door, street, student name, address, course ID, DOB. Then address is a composite attribute. Door, street, student, hobby is a multi-value attribute. Age is a presented in dotted. It is an inherited derived attribute. Then student ID is a key attribute. In this way, course ID is a primary key. Course name, it is simple. Subject, lecture ID, subject name. Lecture ID is primary. Then if we are going to make it in table form, how to convert in tabular form? This is in the tabular form. Now we are just putting student into student table. Student ID, all the I have written the student, lecture table, subject, course, and topic. And these are the relations between them. They are represented in this. MN, 1, M. They are the dependent of one. So we can simply put all the attributes in the column in the student table, and we have to make this student will be student name, the table of the name of the table, and this will be the columns in the table. Okay, these are the simple basics of the database management system. Then we are in the next class, we are going for the what is the normalization, relational data model, join operations, different of relational operations, we are going to mathematical operations, we are going to perform it. Okay, for today, due to time constraint, I am winding up this session at this point. If anyone has any question, he can ask me.
Thank you, sir, for a wonderful session. So I request all learners, if any questions, then they can ask directly. Otherwise, they can ask through chat box. Learner manankar jodi kichi question achi, se mane direct unmute karike, tanko mic ko unmute karike question pachari paribe. नहले चैट बॉक्स थ्रू ने पचारी करिए सर आई थिंक देयर इज नो क्वेश्चन सो वन क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम माय साइड
ओके सर व्हाट
इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन यूनिक की एंड प्राइमरी की
यूनिक की एंड प्राइमरी की ओके unique means, for example, unique in a database system, actually we have divided into different types of keys, one primary key and candidate key. Unique means unique is a set of one or more than one case of a table that uniquely identify record in a database tool. set of or more than one pill. That means uniqueness. I can combine. I can use. I can take use of only ID, or I can use the both ID plus name. I can name, but ID plus name can uniquely identify any tuple or any record. Then you can see the unique key. So SQL unique key constant. For example, in the employee tuple, employee ID is also present. Employee ID can uniquely represent a record, and the name also name cannot represent a uniquely represented tuple. But combining ID plus name, it can uniquely identify that. Then the combination will call the unique key. Okay.
Okay, sir. Is the primary key contain all value?
Okay, right. I have not discussed those things. Okay, I will discuss. Sorry. Okay, primary key cannot contain a null value. We have to insert any value in the primary key, because what is a null value? Null value means if any time of insertion in any time of inserting data into the record, if it is specified as a null value, we can left it blank. But if it is not null value, we have to make any type of value. The primary cannot be a null value. Okay.
But in case of a unique key, it can be a null value.
Yes.
Okay, so I think that is the basic difference.
Okay.
Yes. Sir, schema, please describe schema details. The kind of question they ask you. Database schema.
Okay. What do you mean database schema? Schema is generally the structure, or you can say it is architecture, skeleton. So what will table schema? Then table schema, when we are going to define a table schema, there will be five, suppose n number of columns. Then how to I am going to define the table? That is the schema. And schema can be altered, can be changed in the physical. A schema present at the physical. We have done the three levels. The schema present at the physical level. And schema actually the structure of the table. We can say that. But in the depth, I will discuss in the next part. I'm going to in depth how to alter the schema and how to drop the schema in the thing. But for the moment, you can say that this is general skeleton or structure of the data table. Sorry.
Thank you, sir, for your brilliant session. I think all the learners have listened very well. And I request all the learners, before coming to class, they must go through our self-learning materials so that they can understand very easily. So I request from next class onwards, learners are acquainted with the session which is going on. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Swan, sir. Thank you, Bhavesh, sir. Now we wind up our session here. Thank you all.
Okay. Thank you all, sir.
Thank you, sir.